All right, okay, and I can get rid of my video face. Okay. This should be good to go.
Are we sure now? Are we good? Are you 100%?
Look, dude, I can't guarantee anything anymore because this has been, like, the worst experience ever.
Oh, man. Welcome to recording, Larche.
Yeah, well, no, welcome to trying to do a podcast over Skype.
Sorry.
And
we find a better system. I wonder if Evolve has a better webcam thing.
We're going to have to take a look. But with that, hi, guys. Welcome to Selexert Network's very first and probably very last podcast. I'm Justin, or Larche.
And I'm Mike, or Commander Gino for some people.
It's Mike, mostly, I think.
No, I don't know.
On Twitch, you were Gino. But, like, everyone else always called you Mike, and I always call you Michael.
Yeah, that's true.
So that's true. Yeah, the people I think will know you more as Mike or Michael than Commander Gino or Gino.
Okay, you win.
Flash.
Happy now?
I mean, you open the can. I just wanted to make sure that all the ass whooping comes out. All right. So this is like a test, a beta test, whatever you want to call it, a demo of what we might be doing down the future. There will be two video feeds, so like this way, and then there's going to be a little gameplay of whatever I want it to be at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
If we have something relevant that we're talking about, I might throw it in there if I'm not too lazy, but let's be honest, pretty fucking lazy.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we're going to talk about the things that have been interesting us lately, and one of those things is actually, well, Mike kind of resolved this issue, but I want to talk to him about it anyways.
What?
Mika, yeah, it's about Funhouse.
Yeah.
So yesterday, no. So yesterday, Michael and I were talking, and it was we're just trying to think of some podcast ideas, like things that we can talk about on the show. And this is going to be probably a returning segment where we're going to debate about some about a few topics. This one, in turn, will be Funhouse, aka Inside Gaming Daily, when they used to be Bruce, Adam, James, Joel, Peak, and Spool, and Lawrence. But this is back when they were working for Machinima.
Mm-hmm.
This is when Michael fell in love with these guys, and I think this is when you really wanted to start doing, like, Let's Plays, was when you were watching their GTA footage and stuff.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's exactly what it was, man. That was the start of my want to get back into any of this.
Yeah, because we have done this not a few years ago, we had done it about a year prior, that we were trying to. Like, we basically built this gargantuan world in Minecraft, where we had, like, multiple Let's Play ideas. And on my old channel, we tried to do a recording there. We did about two, I think. There was the maze one, and there was, I think we tried, oh, yeah. And then there was the, like, the behind the scenes, the workshop. Minecraft workshop.
Yeah, I remember that now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember that. So, yeah, that we had done two of those, and it was pretty cool. But then, I don't know, life got in the way, and we just ended up, I stopped recording. And then I started up Selexert Network. I'm like, hey, Mike, let's try this again. Yay!
Sorry.
Yeah.
Good thing you did. I really like doing this.
Well, this is fine. Don't get me wrong. This is awesome. But the thing is at the time, this is when I was showing Michael a bunch of different examples, I think, for Let's Play. So there was, obviously, the Achievement Hunter guys with their Let's Play. There was Inside Gaming's Let's Plays. There were also Game Grumps. Like, a whole bunch of them that I was watching that I was obsessed with. And you really fell in love with the Inside Gaming guys.
Oh, absolutely. Like, they were just, especially James. Man, James, I think, is my favorite guy out of the whole entire team. When he talks about whatever is happening in the game, it's just like, I laugh every freaking time. It's just funny stuff. You know what I mean? Adam is fun, too. But he's always playing the game, right? He always gets too into it.
Yeah, he gets very focused.
Bruce plays off James a lot.
Oh, yeah.
So.
Oh, for me, it's when Bruce gets super excited and he goes, oh! Ah! Like, he just starts losing his mind.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah,
the funnest part.
Oh, that's something that always makes me laugh. Like, that's the, like, that was the pinnacle of their things on Inside Gaming. Then they moved over to Rooster Teeth, and they've called themselves Funhouse.
Yes.
Where apparently Michael, for a while, I don't know why, I think you're a little drunk and crazy, was saying that it was not as good as the stuff they used to do on their original channel.
It just changed. Originally, right, it was Adam Plays the Game. The other two guys sit back. You don't really see Lawrence that much until, like, some whatever podcasty thing they do. And Spool was always in the background. And I'm glad this fool, you know, he's come out and all that stuff.
He's to come out? What do you mean? What do you mean, come out?
Like,
come out of the closet, Michael? Is that what you're trying to say?
Sure, yeah. No, he's just more, he's more of a personality. He's more, there's more of him.
Yeah.
And I like that. I really do. But at the same time, it just seems like now they have those open house things, which I'm not really a big fan of. Like, the one day, what was it? They did, like, all the art pictures.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
In the art things, and that was kind of cool the one time. Then the second time, I was just like, okay, no, this is not what I watch you for. But then I recently watched it again because Larcy said it was crazy, and I said, well, you know what, I'm gonna just see. And you're right, there are a few things that I like, and it's all the stuff where they're actually playing the game,
mm-hmm.
or doing the gameplay stuff, you know, and whether it's you get all the camera views of them and their different, you know,
their desks,
and their different point of views,
yeah.
Or if it's like the traditional Adams in there, and then you got Bruce and James in the back. And that's what I love about them. That is the exact stuff that I watched them to begin with. So when they changed over, it was kind of a rough, I guess you could call it a rough patch for me.
Well, I think what was going on, and I don't, like, this is me not trying to defend them, because like, I personally have always enjoyed what they were doing. It was when they transferred over to from Machinima to Rooster Teeth, they were just like, I think they got a blank check to do whatever they wanted. So, like, they started trying a bunch of different stuff. They had their commentary thing. Then they had their art show that you were talking about. And then they also started doing the demo disc, which is now...
Oh, yes.
Which demo disc pretty much has now devolved into just anime cartoon porn. Just a bunch of Flash games of just, yeah. Like, and it's always blurred out.
Yeah, well, it's basically started that way. I'm thinking, what was it? The second one in. Was all of a sudden now there's just boobs everywhere. They're talking about like all these different things, and I'm like, okay, cool, that's kind of funny, but that's not what I'm watching you guys for at all.
But now recently they've been doing a lot more mod stuff, and they've been bringing back their GTA Let's Plays, like when they do their group community stuff. Mm-hmm. And that's their bread and butter, right? And I think they've realized that, so they're kind of sticking with it now.
Yeah. And that's the recent videos I've seen, like there's been a lot of gameplay ones. Instead of, well, they still have the podcast, which Spool's podcast. I mean, that's, I kind of enjoy that for sure. And that's why I'm glad Spool came out more. So, anyways, but yeah, they're going back to what people watched, I think people came to watch them in the beginning.
Yeah. And that, well, like you said, like that's the stuff that you had fallen in love with. So I could see how it would be a little bit shitty when they started playing. Dabbling in more different, like different fields, where they were doing like the open house more, they were doing the demo reel and all the demo games and all that in the wheelhouse, and like they weren't really doing what you were used to. So like I said, like it'd be a bit of a pain in the ass. But I mean, you gotta admit, they've pretty much stayed the same. Now, like it's, they found their formula and they're sticking with it now.
Yeah, I mean the personality wise, especially, they're definitely the same people.
Yeah,
like that hasn't changed at all. James is still who he is. Bruce. Adam, you know, all the guys. So, am I mad in general? Not really. I mean, Funhouse is still fun, so.
So, that's that your new argument?
That's all I got.
So.
So, and then I leave the rest to the world. To the universe, Larche. It's just out there.
This is you. Yeah! That's you right now, man.
Yeah, that's basically. Quarters of the time, so
yeah. Well, to talk about one obsession to another, there's something that I sent to Michael a couple articles. Well, we did back and forth, and one of them that I'd found, and then Michael had found it too, was it was a report from Pornhub.
Oh, that is so freaking hilarious.
So, for those who don't know, there is this little indie title that people may not have heard of called Fallout 4 that came out recently, and on
who hasn't heard of it?
I don't know, but on this release, Pornhub had, well, let me see here, so I got the article right here. Pornhub reports a 10% traffic drop the day Fallout 4 came out. What the hell, man? So you're telling me there are that many people, well, I guess it makes sense that, you know, the people who watch porn and the people who play video games, I mean, there's not that far of a diagram, like, everyone kind of comes together for that. Ew. But it was interesting. It's kind of interesting to see the timelines, which is what I want to talk about here. So one of the things they were saying, let's see here. So dropped at 11 p.m. Da, 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 da. So yeah, like when you look at the demographic, they were saying Just as a heads up, Fallout already has sold 12 million physical, or has shipped 12 million physical copies of the game, which many people call that a success. I say that doesn't count, because shipped doesn't equal to purchased.
Yeah.
So, like, it's cool that they shipped that many copies out, but that doesn't really mean that they're going to sell all that. Mind you, it's Fallout 4, so obviously they're going to sell 12 million copies. Like, that's not the issue.
Mm-hmm.
But I just don't like when people tote those numbers. Or they're just like, oh, you know, we've reshipped out $30 million worth of games. We're the greatest manufacturer of all time.
Yeah. Like, I've never liked that either. Yeah. It's just like, I mean, you're trying to, what, flash it out there and nobody really cares that much.
Well, it's what they did with, whatchamacallit, with Advanced Warfare. When Advanced Warfare came out, they were touting how Advanced Warfare had shipped over, we'll say like, I can't remember what the number was anymore, but we'll say like 50 million copies to stores worldwide. And it's like, wow, you guys wasted a lot of money selling or shipping out this product that you haven't even guaranteed that people are going to purchase.
That's
compared
right.
to when you were looking at GTA 5, when that came out, the first day it came out, it didn't ship, you know, 12 million copies, it made $1 billion in like 3 days with the stuff I don't know which one I'm looking for. I don't know if I want to look at the webcam or you on screen, so I keep jumping between the two.
I'm trying to bring them both together as much as they can, you know?
But you know, GTA 5 actually made $1 billion off their total copy sold, so that's what always bugs me. But anyways, the thing I wanted to talk about was from 5 a.m until 3 p.m. the day it was released, they had a 10% viewership or jerk-off ship drop. I don't know what to call it exactly.
What was the time you said?
So this is how long this is, dude. 5 a.m. and continued until around 3 p.m.
Oh yeah, okay, I see.
That's almost 12 hours of people being like, eh, I don't really want to do this anymore. I'm gonna go play me some video games. You know, it's like, yeesh, man. Let me see here. And it says, the traffic began to decrease again at 6 p.m. and didn't return to normal levels until around 11 p.m. So they had about a 3-hour gap where they're just like, man, playing video games is hard. And then just like, fap, 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 fap. Like, that's what happened.
I'm looking at the graph. I was just thinking, I'm thinking, okay, so they had fun, you know, through lunch, through the morning, all that stuff. They had dinner, at least at one point.
They needed some kind of nourishment for themselves.
Yeah. They had a little fun with the fapping off at that time, too. And then they're like, I want to play more video games.
Oh my
and then
God.
Right after, I swear, after 10 p.m. or even 11 p.m., people in the game must have got to the point where they're just like, I feel terrible.
Yeah.
So next, you know, the number goes right up there, and they're right off.
Oh, man. Yeah, that's messed up. That's like I get it. Fallout 4 is a big game. But that's an obsession, man. You're going to go that long. And, like, literal, what they call themselves the world's biggest porn site, they can actually track a big dip and they can associate it with Fallout 4. That is insane, man. Like, that doesn't make any sense.
Still, though, the thing is look at, okay, November 10th, the same time frame where there's that huge spike from basically 11 to 4 in the PM to AM.
Mm-hmm.
Like, look at the numbers. If that's in millions, which I'm pretty sure it is, a percentage of whatever.
Yeah.
Like, you're almost, what, double? So from 5% to 15% in the same, like, basically time. So what are they complaining about, really?
I don't know.
I mean, sure, they didn't get that many numbers through lunchtime and breakfast and all that stuff, but, like, seriously, who's fapping that early in the freaking morning, really?
You'd be surprised.
I suppose. I don't think I want to know.
Look, when you wake up early and you don't want to disturb the wife or the kid, you just put some headphones on, you know, you light up a couple of candles and you just go to town.
How do you get a morning wood? I can understand that.
But anyways, all right, I'm going to close this tab now because I think we are done with this dirty, dirty subject. But the other thing I want to talk about is both something that Pat is actually very obsessed with that's coming out. I think it's Tuesday. Yeah, I think it's in 2 days because technically this is it's the 15th right now. I don't know when this is going to come out. I haven't decided when yet, but this is November 15th. So in 2 days, November 17th, Star Wars Battlefront comes out.
Yeah, I'm kind of excited for it. I mean, the thing is, though,
say it, come on.
Like, it felt kind of Call of Duty-ish. this is the one thing that I don't like about all these games that are coming out that are multiplayer, and especially the FPSs. They've decided they need to be more like Call of Duty, whether it's Black Ops, Spec Ops, blah, 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 all the ops, Modern Warfare. So they decide they need to make it as arena-like as possible. But the nice thing Battlefront did that I do appreciate is they sort of went to their roots, which was kind of like the Battlefield series, right? So there's objectives, there's things you've got to do, and, you know, especially the one mode, which I forget what it's called now, but essentially where you have the AT-AT walking.
Assault. I think it's Assault.
Yeah, so you guys essentially had to push your way through, and that kind of reminded me, remember Battlefield 4? Remember that one mode where it was like that? You had to take point here.
Oh, yeah, and you continuously progress through and through and through, and the map got bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
Well, I played that in 3. I played that with 3 with you.
Yes, that's what it was. 3. Yeah. But even that, like, that still reminds me of a Call of Duty's kind of curbing to the game. So where you're still trying to give what you want to give, but you're also trying to conform to what apparently every teenage boy is doing.
Well, that's the thing, right? Is a lot of people now are, at least like the game developers, are seeing, well, for a while, the success Call of Duty had, right? And like they're trying to associate what made it so popular, and everyone keeps on saying the multiplayer.
Yeah.
Look, I'm not in the game business. I don't know all the statistics and all the stuff, but from what I can see, from what the game developers are trying to do, is they want to have a game that is fun and fast, mm-hmm. because that's what they think kids want. They want something that'll end and start right away, and that's what Call of Duty is, and still kind of is now, where like you die and you respawn in like 2 seconds, you're back on the field. In Battlefront, and again, this was just a demo, but still, in the Battlefront demo, you died, and almost immediately, you could just respawn either on your partner or back at your spawn point, and you just rush back in. And like, yeah, it was just like this fast, continuous, hard push that, you know, on Assault, if you're the Empire, it's fantastic. Gotta calm down. It's fantastic because you just constantly push the Rebels all the way back until there's nothing left. Or, you know, you're the Rebels and you can't stop this wave of enemies that just constantly are pushing towards you. And the AT-ATs, which were, I'll be honest, in the demo, you couldn't beat them.
No.
Like, yeah, there was. Sure. And I think they even tweeted, Battlefront, I don't know if it was from the main Twitter account or one of the developers, but they said, yeah, we know the AT-AT assault was a little bit too, rough. So they're going to do some tweaking. Motherfucker, there needs to be a little tweaking. It was a miracle if you can kill one AT-AT. You can kill one AT-AT, that the game should have ended there. But the fact that there's another one like 30 feet away that was still approaching and only lost a quarter of his health, bull, man. That was just no way.
No. Yeah, it's definitely a lot more typical for the Rebels, especially in that mode. It just felt like you were... But that's the thing. You know what? Honestly, if you're going to go with a more authentic Star Wars feel to it, face it. That's exactly what happened.
I know.
In Empire Strikes Back, you know? So,
I get that, but it's still, dude, like, I know that you want to keep it faithful so that you can make it difficult, but that was impossible. Like, I got a chance when I was the speeder. Is it the speedster? Speeder? Snowspeeder.
Yeah, speeder. Yeah. Snowspeeder, yeah.
And I was literally wrapping around the legs of the AT-AT, and I got it. It's a success. I'm like, yay! The game ends right away. You fail or defeated. I'm like, what the fuck is this? Like, really? This is the only time they let the snow speeders wrap around.
That's right.
And it's like there's like 5 seconds left before the game ends. So you have to guarantee that both snow speeders that are unleashed can both grab their own AT-ATs and kill them right away. Because if not, you're screwed. That is it. Yeah. That is the end of the game.
Well, that's what I mean. Like, the whole... Okay, this is the one thing I wish they did. The maps need to be bigger. There needs to be more to it. There needs to be... Like, it just felt like, for example, it funneled. Okay, so it went from here, and then it funneled in towards where the Rebel base was, and then it ballooned out again.
Like an hourglass type of thing.
Yeah, it was basically an hourglass. And, you know, there was no real way to flank. There was no... Like, there was turrets over here and turrets here. But then there was like an AT-AT over here that was walking along. You know what I mean? It was so unbalanced, I feel.
Well, okay, keep in mind, this is the one map that they had for Assault, right?
Yeah.
And I'm pretty sure they still have Endor. Is it Endor? Is that the forest world?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Endor,
yeah. Where the little Ewoks. Rats are from. Yeah, Ewoks. Look, I'm not a Star Trek...
They're more like bears.
Whatever, they're rats, okay? They're like little raccoons.
No!
The raccoon's on steroids, okay? Don't worry about it. Which, fun fact, I didn't know this, you probably already know this, but apparently that planet was originally supposed to be the planet of Wookiees, and the Ewoks were supposed to be Wookiees.
Yeah.
And, like, that would have been so much more badass if it would have been Wookiees fighting back, not little teddy bears.
But you gotta, okay, you gotta think about it. If we're gonna get into this kind of discussion.
Go for it, go for it.
Why would they build a super secret space station on a world that's probably more important because it has a race of people that can kill people with their bare fists?
Look, so I don't know how advanced the Wookiees are. From looking at Chewbacca, he doesn't look that, like, he has a blaster, but I think it's a blaster Han gave him. They don't look like, they look, to me, it would have been like what the Ewoks had, sticks and stones.
Well, if you go based off of George Lucas's next three movies, after all those,
yeah,
the Wookiees have technology, but they also choose to live in a certain way that kind of is
sticks and stone.
Yeah, it's parallel to the Ewoks, right?
Yeah.
So they do have the blasters, they do have all this technology, but they choose to live this other way. So, I mean, and again, even in some of the books and stuff like that, Kashyyyk, which is the planet of the Wookiees, I'm pretty sure it has a political aspect to it. It had a strategic aspect to it. And it had resources that they wanted more than Endor did. Endor was just kind of like some moon off in the bum frick nowhere that nobody cared about.
So then explain that to me. Why would they want to do that?
Because they don't want anybody. Okay, think of it like this, Larche. If you were like some country in the world and you were trying to make a nuclear bomb, would you put it in your capital city?
No, I'm not. Okay, first of all, it's the Empire. I'm pretty sure the Empire didn't have a capital world to begin with.
Yeah, they did. It's called Coruscant. Yeah, that's right.
Anyways, the point being, yeah, you don't have to put in the. Okay, but see, that's the thing that doesn't make any sense. If you put in the middle of buttfuck nowhere, then there's the chance that, again, like, you don't know. Like, apparently Ewoks can come in and destroy you, because somehow that makes perfect sense. I'm not going to get started. I don't... Explain to me how an Ewok can take two pieces of log and break an AT-ST.
Okay, that's where you get into some of the debates that I like to get into, where it's like, that would never happen, because obviously the Empire, it's metal! And it's not stupid paper-thin metal.
Yeah, it's not...
aluminum. Okay, you'd need some big freaking trunks, and they would have to swing at a certain speed in order to crush
to literally papier-mâché that thing.
Yeah, so, I mean, like, there's inconsistencies.
Yeah.
Especially, well, I mean, okay, let's face it, though. If we were going to get super accurate, then Stormtroopers would be kicking butt all the time, because
they're Boba Fett's, Boba Fett's dad.
No, because that is another thing. Again, where, okay, there is the Clone Wars, right?
Yeah.
So there's all the clone troops.
After Jango Fett.
Clone Wars. Yes. No. Yes.
Yeah, Jango Fett was Boba Fett's dad.
Yeah. So he was the kind of sample they used to make all the clones. Right?
Yes.
But after the Clone Wars end, with the rise of Palpatine as the official emperor of the Empire, he cuts the Clone Wars completely off. The whole program gets scrapped. He keeps the clones that are still there,
yeah,
but then also recruits new people from the general population.
They don't say that in the movies.
No, they don't. And they don't even actually say it in any of the books, minus the fact that a lot of stormtroopers, like, in some of the things, how they act and all that stuff, it's not, you know what I mean? It's not Jango Fett.
Yeah.
Like, it's just the personality is different, like, the way everything...
Well, they're high, the way they talk, everything.
So my argument is that's my basis for my argument when it comes to that thing is you have the clones and you have these guys working in tandem now, and they're basically spread out so that it's a mixed force.
Which would make sense when you look at episode 7 coming out, where in episode 7 you have Finn, who's not Jango Fett, he is a black guy. He is a black stormtrooper, which I think is whatever. Like, I don't care. I mean, there was a lot of hubbub about it at one point. Who fucking cares? He's a person. He's an awesome actor. Let's just move on.
That's right.
But the issue that I had was, I'm like, I wanted to know how they're gonna explain that. Well, ignore that phone. So you guys didn't hear that. But I guess that's what they're gonna have to do, right? And I'm sure they're gonna explain. I guarantee they're gonna explain that in the movie. Where they're going to be in episode 7, they're going to be like, oh yeah, there's, you know, there's a recruitment field on the left for high school. Go on, fight with the Empire. Or no, what do they call it now? The First Order? Or the New Order? What do they call themselves now?
Like the Galactic Order?
No, no. They call themselves something different in Episode 7. I think it's the New Order. Or the First Order.
Because they get destroyed, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, okay. First of all, there's so many debates in Star Wars, it's ridiculous, right? Because once Disney decided to take over Star Wars, they said anything after Return of the Jedi that was made in a book is scrapped. It's no longer canon.
Yeah.
So they decanonized all this content, all this history that was made that George Lucas or LucasArts had a whole department to make sure that it all became canonized.
Yeah.
Right? So essentially, you take all that, you put it in a trash bin, because even in all those books, it was still the Galactic Empire. It was still the Empire. Empire, right?
Mm-hmm.
So now the fact that they're going to change it to the First Order... I mean, you might as well just call it the Sith Order, and that would make a little more sense.
No, because according to this one, the Sith and Jedis don't exist anymore. They're like legends of... they're like fables of days of past, you know what I mean?
But that goes... What?
Yeah, you didn't know
what
that?
What about freaking Luke?
See, but Luke isn't even in the... Like, he's in the movie, obviously. Like, Mark Hamill's in the movie. But yeah. I don't think that they're actually going to... It's maybe halfway through when Rey and Finn start talking to Han Solo. When that you see in the trailers, like, everything you heard about, you know, the Rebels or the Jedis and the Sith, it's all true. Because to them, I think this is like 30 years after the events of Episode 6. And what they're trying to show is people just don't believe in magic anymore. The midichlorians and all that. Which I want to see if they're going to explain that.
I hope they destroy the midichlorian theory.
It would be nice. It's not a theory. It's not a theory.
Retarded.
Okay, look. The midichlorians are dumb. Like that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. And I can't believe that they did that with Qui-Gon Jinn. Like poking a needle and whatever. And Anakin can be like, oh, wow, your midichlorians are off the charts. And it's like, shut the fuck up, man. Like, we don't need an explanation as to why he's powerful. You just be like, he's a powerful Jedi or Sith. That is the end of it.
That's right.
Like, just move on from there. You have, every so often, you have a person who's super strong, and there you go.
No.
But anyways, going back to Battlefront.
Yeah, seriously.
So we also played, what is it, the drop pod mission?
Yes, that was really fun.
That was fun, but that one reminded me more of a Call of Duty Capture the Flag King of the Hill position type of thing. Or I guess maybe more, a bit more like Halo in that aspect. But again, it was, that one was super fast paced. It was, what, eight? Was it 4v4 on that one?
No, it was more than that.
Was it 8v8? Yeah, 8v8. So. It was 8v8. No. So you had 8v8 in a small map, but like that was a small map.
Okay, the nice thing about that map was it was a circle. Okay?
Yeah.
That's essentially what it was. It was a big giant circle. And
with pits,
the pod came down. Yeah, with pits.
With pits, Michael.
Many times, yes. The first few seconds. Anyways, so it's just a circle, right? So you can flank. You can get around a lot of mm-hmm. stuff. Whereas in the other one, the assault. I mean, there were other people that did it, but like when you got to that one point, it just didn't feel like you were able to do those maneuvers anymore, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I guess that's kind of where my main issue is. Like, I enjoyed the drop zone, but you're right. It did feel very fast-paced. It did feel very Call of Duty-ish. And it just... It goes into such a... I don't know, a very easy way to make the game mm-hmm. likable, right? You just throw people in a pit and see what happens. Well, of course they're going to kill each other.
Yeah. No, you're not wrong. You're not wrong. There's one thing that they did, which I'm happy they actually did, was there's no recoil on your laser, like on your blasters.
Mm-hmm.
Which, because like the moment I started shooting, I'm like, if this thing starts jerking upwards, I'm going to get so pissed. Because in the movies, it was just a pew, 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 pew. It was a straight shot. And thankfully, that's what it was.
Well, it's like, okay, if you took a laser pointer, for example, and you shot it against the wall...
You don't go...
It's not going to be anything. It's just going to be... Right? So, yeah, okay, these lasers are more high intensity where they can actually kill a person, but it's still the same concept.
Well, because the lasers aren't being propelled forward. There's nothing that's kicking it out of the chamber. It's just, I don't know what to call it exactly, but it's just a force of energy that shoots out.
Yeah, it's just a concentration of energy into a beam that gets launched, or not launched, but just it ends up going out.
Yeah.
Whereas, you know, guns today... It's combustion. That's
how it's a pin that hits and then boom.
Yeah, and then there's that explosion. That's what causes the recoil.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm happy that he doesn't have that, thankfully. That I'm happy about.
as a whole, it was a really, really good game. The fact that you could use TIE Fighters, X-Wings, like all these different aspects where you could call drop orbital drops, like they added more than what they had before. And it was all good stuff, for sure. Like more different weapons. And you can find these things on the map. It's not like, oh, I have this in my inventory. I'm just going to boop, 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 boop. And, oh, now I'm in a TIE Fighter. No, like, you had to find it on the map. Hopefully, you don't die.
No, don't remind me.
Yeah, that was freaking hilarious the one time.
I kept wanting to get a goddamn speeder or an X-Wing, and always someone would come up, boop, I'm going to grab it. Boop, I'm going to grab it. Right in front of me. I got so mad, man.
The one time I tried getting an AT-AT. Ran up to it. Oh, I'm going to get... I got killed by two different rebels. It's like, how? Why do that?
Yeah. Did you, did you get a chance to play as a hero?
Yeah, no.
No, I think... Wait. Was Pat the only one who got to play as Luke or Vader?
Pat got Luke, you got Vader.
I never got Vader. I never got a chance to play as a hero. Nope.
Didn't you?
Nope. I wish.
Well, maybe it was me. It was me, that's right. I was Vader at one point. And I was running around just throwing my lightsaber at Luke. That's what it was. Yes, I forgot about
that. Oh, man.
That was hilarious, though. I tried choke-forcing a couple people and then dying. I mean, it was anticlimactic, let's put it that way.
Well, I mean, the thing is you were Darth Vader in an open spot where many, like, 20 people could shoot at you, right? Yeah. If you would have been in the Rebel base, you could have just flung your lightsaber and choked and pushed people. Like, you would have been just fine.
Because yeah,
you could deflect, you could deflect blazer blasts with your saber.
Oh yeah, that was really cool. Did that for sure.
Well, yeah, so all in all, I mean, if you had the money, so this is the rule because we're both broke as fuck.
Yeah.
If you had the money, it's coming out Tuesday. Would you buy Battlefront?
If I had the money, absolutely.
Yeah.
I think I would. It's something fun to get onto every now and then.
With you get some friends together and just start having a game.
But other than that, is it worth how much they're selling it for?
Yeah, it's so full price. Full price. Yeah, all online only.
It's just too much for a game anymore. $80 in comparison to what?
In Canada.
Yeah, in Canada. Like, $50, I would say, would be more than enough for this type of game.
Well, it is very interesting that now developers are defending the fact that they are not putting single-player campaigns into these games. Be like, oh, well, no one really plays it, blah, 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 blah. Then it's like, okay, well, you say that people don't play a single-player campaign, so you want to take it out. Fine. Yeah. I understand that. But then you should be adding so much more to your online content to make it still in the States, a $60 value, or in Canada, a $74.99 value. Like, you need to guarantee me that because you're taking away, which for me, myself personally, I love playing single-player campaigns. I like going through storylines and learning what's happening with stuff. I've done that since, God knows when, since I got my first 360. Every time a first-person shooter came out, I would always play a single-player campaign first, and then I would jump into multiplayer.
Yeah.
I've done that for every single Halo game, and I'll never stop that. Halo 5 was the exact same thing. I would play it, beat the campaign first, and then join multiplayer. That's what I do.
The thing is, though, Larshi, is when you get some of these games that they don't put enough of a story or a good enough story for their single player, and then they wonder why all their, kids that they're trying to get to play the game don't play the single player and are online all the time. I mean, obviously, you should cut it out. But if you're going to cut it out, you're right. Throw more into the multiplayer.
Yeah.
Like, dedicate everything
to
multiplayer and add more to it as opposed to just saying, oh, it was good before. Now it's making more money, woohoo, better graphics, whoop-de-doo.
See, that's what I'm hoping Battlefront will fix, because Battlefront has Assault, Drop Pod, they have like a Horde mode, they have a Fighter Squadron, which is just the air vehicles, and I think the last one is Hero versus Villains. So you could just straight up have like a Luke, Darth Vader fight. That's it. So I think that's what it is.
Or co-op thing.
They had like a co-op thing going on, but not single player. Like, not an actual single player story mode. So I'm assuming single player mode, if they have it in Battlefront, will just be you against NPCs in the same maps that you would in a multiplayer setting.
But, even Halo 5, which is the next one we should probably talk about for sure.
See, that's why I talked about Halo 5, because it's a segue.
Yeah,
You'll catch on.
Halo 5. Actually, you know what? Let's go right into it now because there's something in that one article that proves that single players are still something that are content-wise good and that players want in their games. So let's just go over that right now. So this article, me and Larche, we both love Halo.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's probably my favorite FPS franchise.
Yeah, for sure. Especially the story. It's excellent.
Yep. Excellent.
Except for a few of them.
Which we'll talk about this. Once we're done this, we'll count down our top favorite, like from beginning to bottom, our favorite Halo games. But anyways, go.
Okay, anyway, so this is saying that Microsoft or they announced how much money essentially they generated in the first week. And they got, well, this goes into our argument about, you know, basically flashy, hey, look at us, look how much money.
Yeah.
They got $400 million in the first week. So it is, they're saying it's the biggest Halo or the biggest Halo launch they ever had in forever.
They cheated though.
Of course they cheated. They always cheat.
They cheated in the sense that a lot of that came from selling hardware with the game.
Mm-hmm.
So you buy an Xbox One, you get Halo 5.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But anyways, later in the article it says that, you know, how much time
people
put into, which I thought was ridiculous.
Yeah, here it is right here. So, fans have logged more than 21 million hours of total gameplay, including 12 million hours in campaign mode alone.
Yeah, and that's where, that point right there, 12 million hours in campaign mode, which, I mean, yes, there is a co-op part of it, but I still believe that at least three quarters of that number is single player.
What?
So I even, you know, I'm not a fan of single player anymore myself, but even I got into the single player story of Halo 5. It's just, and they, I think Halo 5 definitely saved the Halo franchise.
Yeah.
100%.
Yeah.
Because it was a mess. After Halo Reach, I think things just went.
Well, people panicked. I mean, Halo 4 did a really good job.
Yeah.
I remember you and I played that together for co-op, which is fun. The only problem I found with that one is I found it extremely short. I found Halo 4 to be really, really short. Halo 5 wasn't as bad, which was nice. There's a couple of story issues I have with it, which was in Halo 5, which I don't know if they actually explain it, or maybe I missed it. Did you beat the game yet?
No, I haven't, sadly.
Okay, what part are you up to?
I'm up to... Whoa, what was it now? Something about the newest Guardian that's on that one planet.
Sang Helios? Okay.
No.
Okay. Damn it, I can't... Okay, it's mild spoiler. I'm sorry, Michael, okay?
I don't care.
Not really a mild spoiler. It just doesn't make any sense to me, to be honest. They go from... So Timur Sires is commissioned to go after Master Chief and capture him and then stop Cortana. That is their mission. To bring back Chief home, no matter what, and stop Cortana.
Right.
I don't know where in the story this switch to them wanting to help Chief and stop Cortana. They don't explain why at any point. They're just like, oh, hey, Chief, hey, we're here to help now. What? Why? Why are you now helping the Chief?
I wish I had played more of it now.
Don't worry, you'll see it, and you'll be like, what the fuck? Like, what is going on?
Well, there are some things. I guess I'm not there yet. Like, I'm getting some inklings about how I feel that's going to happen.
Like, they're going to do the Switch?
Yeah, they're going to do the Switch based on, like, some of the stuff they're getting from Halsey and from UNSC Command, and then some of the stuff they're seeing from the Arbiter, and like, you know, Covenant and all that stuff. Like, I think, and now I know, thanks for the spoiler, Lucci.
I warned you, and you said it was okay.
But anyways, I can definitely see that they're going to help each other in the future. So, I mean, we'll see. I guess I'll have to play some more myself in order to experience that moment of
Well, that's the thing, right? Because it reminds me of in Gears of War 1, there's a mission, and I think it's one of the last missions where, like, you just destroyed an e-hole, or you went down to the nest, you destroyed it all up, you come back up, and the guy's like, so and so has the bomb on the train. Oh no, we gotta go stop him. And it's like, what? What train? What bomb are you talking about? And then 2 seconds later, you're gonna drop off onto the train to stop the big bad, whatever they're called in that game, Locust guy. To stop this magic bomb that apparently they had this whole time but decided not to tell you about it. And then, but Marcus is like, oh yeah, the bomb, we should go stop that. It's like, what are you talking about?
You don't remember?
No!
Didn't they drop a bomb down the hole?
No, that was like a sonar to see how big the holes are, the tunnels were.
Yeah, but there was also to get a bomb down there to explode it to kill all the
locusts. Are you sure, Michael?
I'm fairly certain.
Then how did the locusts get the bomb?
Because
and why was it on a train?
I mean... Okay, so you got I haven't played Halo, or I mean...
Gears?
Gears 1 in forever. I think I have all three.
Yeah, I think we both have all three, if I'm not mistaken. Which, hey, with the new Xbox Rewind feature...
Great.
We might, maybe we'll do a couple of Gears playthroughs. That'd be pretty sweet.
That would be pretty sweet.
But anyways, to Halo, going back to Halo 5.
Yeah.
That is a good point, like you said, to prove that people still care about a good campaign.
Absolutely.
It has to be... Yes, it has to be an entertaining story. Like, if without that, it's just... It's going to be poo-poo. Another thing they did in Halo 5, which I'm happy with... I don't know if you noticed in Halo 4, their sound quality was a kind of low res. It was a little bit lower resolution. It was very strange. Like, the bumps and, like... The walking, even the shooting, something didn't sound crisp. And then you hear it in Halo 5, and like everything's very toned and fleshed out, where it's like, boom, like a nice thud, a big explosion. You feel the explosion now, and like the quality just seemed to like up like through the roof this time.
Okay, there are some story points though that really kind of threw me off, mostly about the Covenant and the kind of civil war they're having, and the UNSC's role anymore.
So
all of a sudden, UNSC is like, oh, we don't have any worries. Let's just send these guys over here to get the chief and go to Sigulios and, like, all these things. And meanwhile, the Arbiter, which I'm pretty sure in, like, Halo 3, they're like, we won! Right? But all of a sudden, they're like, oh my gosh, we're losing! Help us! Ah!
Okay. In all technicality, I think what happened on that was, so at the end of Halo 3... I think Ron Perlman was just like, I know we've killed a lot of yours and you've killed much more of ours. I don't know if we'll ever really be able to trust each other, but this is the first step. Something like kind of like this is the first step thing at Chief's grave. And the Arbiter's like, oh, the Chief was a good man, blah, 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 blah. And then they whatever. And I think they shook hands or they saluted. Something happened at the end. I don't know. They fucking jerked each other off. Something happened. Fucking I'm Dutch Rudder. Sure. I don't know.
I've seen that. Stuff
it's the uncut. It's the unrated version. So the director's cut of Halo 3. But anyways, they parted ways. And then I'm pretty sure the UNSC is just like, well, fuck, we're done. We don't need to worry about the Covenant. Because if I'm not mistaken, until the events of Halo 4 and 5, the rest of the Covenant never actually bothered mankind. At least not in the inner colonies. And the outer colonies, I think they're still getting assaulted because they were looking for this Forerunner planet, if I'm not mistaken. And then the Arbiter knew about this, so then but he just cared about his people and saying Helios. And then when Oni dropped in to talk to the Arbiter in Halo 5, they're just like, we haven't had much contact with each other, but it's like, if you help me, I help you. And that was like the understanding, and that's pretty much as far as it went.
Yeah, I guess. But even, like, there's another moment where it's like, oh, we're going to this one planet. It's an independent world. What?
Yeah, like, why are you doing that?
First of all, UNSC, even some of the, like, first stories is, if you're not UNSC, you're Rebel. And if you're Rebel, then we kill you. Right?
But see...
Like, that's what the Spartan program was supposed to be.
Yes, originally they were, they were supposed to be the people that were going to take out the Rebel insurgents.
Yeah.
But in Halo Reach, the game, they kind of touch upon that a little bit. But then once the moment the Covenants hit Reach, that all went out the window.
But you see, that's the thing is, Reach, that game, ruined so much story for me, especially as being a reader of the books.
Yeah, because you read a lot of the books.
I read all the books except for two, because at that point it was just like, and I don't care about this part of the story.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, it's nothing for me. I read one where I was like, that did not contribute at all to the Halo franchise. Thank you for wasting my money kind of thing. But, like, the book, Halo Reach, it came way before the game. You know, even the book for the game itself was excellent. First Strike. There was another one after... That kind of is like, between, or no, it's like way before. And it's about how Admiral Cole won and all this stuff, like some of his earlier victories, even though they were losing worlds, right? And it's like, there's, even when Reach fell, it was still the understanding, right? You are UNSC or you're Rebel. Like, there's no, the Civil War is not done just because the Covenant are here.
Yeah.
And, but then you get to the game and they're kind of like, well, the colonies are screwed. Let's just make sure Earth is okay, though. And it's like, what? Like,
yeah, because for some of the Rebels, right? Some of the Rebels, it's like, yeah, but our Earth is fucking planet Xenon the Fifth. Yeah, like, that's exactly. Our Earth. Your Earth, even though it's called Earth, isn't important to us. So save us, please, and our planet Earth.
And even then, if you go back to Halo Reach, all right, with the whole, the ending, all right, where they give Cortana to Keyes, who looks very young, considering.
Yeah, because that technically takes the events right before the right before Halo, the first game.
Yeah, which the first game, it's... You even get the feeling from it, and the books, like, play right into it, right?
Yeah.
Where they just come from Reach, escaping the Covenant.
Yeah.
All right? Ensuring that the Master Chief is okay and Cortana's okay.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, Master Chief is alone, but he had a team. Like, you get that feeling right off the bat, right? And then just take that whole thing and poop on it. Like, what about the Master Chief? Like, that's what I was asking. After Halo Reach,
well, because in Reach, the Reach of the game, or in the books, I mean, it's the stories about Chief and his team, right, with Linda and
Oh, it's about their beginning.
Yeah,
right. And that's what I thought the game was gonna be, but no. Then they went, screw you, Master Chief.
Yeah,
we're gonna bring a whole whack load of new idiots
that we've never heard of before.
Spartans, but they're more Oni than Spartans, and now they're like going up to Halsey. And, like, pretending like they're gonna arrest her.
Yeah.
What? What do you mean? First of all, never would happen. Okay. Like, that's... The Spartans are her children, essentially.
Well, those Spartan 2s. Right? The Spartan 2s, which John came from, was her kids.
No, pretty Spartan much. Mark 4.
Mark 4? Right?
Mark 4.
I thought they were Spartan 2s, though.
No, well, I don't know.
Isn't it armor? Wasn't it Spartan armor Mark 4, but they were the Spartan 2 program?
I don't remember, actually.
Because, if I'm not mistaken, the new generation, Halo 5, with Locke, he was Gen 5? I think they were Spartan 5s? Spartan 4s?
Dude, this goes into some of the story stuff. Like, even some of the books, like Onyx or something of Onyx.
Yeah.
I think it tried to bridge the Halo Reach game with the old story.
Okay.
They actually tried to do as well as I thought they could. So essentially this colonel was stealing Halsey's stuff, secrets and stuff, to make his own Spartan program.
Yeah.
But that Spartan program was essentially throwaways. So yeah, you give them armor, you give them all the cool toys, but essentially they do missions where they essentially never come back. Period.
Yeah, no suicide runs. Else.
Yeah. Doesn't matter. They are dying. Okay? And, you know, that kind of, like, especially with how they were describing the armor and the gadgets and stuff like that in the books, It was like, yeah, okay, I can now accept this new Halo Reach game. But there's still inconsistencies. You know, like, what was it, George or something? The big guy in Halo Reach. He somehow knows Halsey?
Yeah, he keeps calling her mom and stuff.
Yeah, so he must have been part of this Spartan whatever program.
Yeah, Spartan 2 program.
These other ones was definitely not.
Well, because their size, too, was so different. Well, and you see that in Halo 5 with Chief and Locke. Because Chief's like, BAM!
Yeah.
And Locke's is burp. Like a huge size difference.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and even then, like, the ranking system is garbage in comparison to how people perceived it after Halo 1, right? Yeah. Master Chief was Master Chief.
No one surpassed him.
Yeah, Master Chief was the ultimate of and the top ranking Spartan, period.
Yeah.
But then you get into Halo Reach and then all of a sudden, hey, Lieutenant, what?
Yeah.
What do you mean, Lieutenant? That's an officer rank. That is not a non-commissioned officer rank.
Yeah.
So anyways.
All right. So to end this Halo conversation, kind of, because we could go a very long time talking about this.
Oh, absolutely.
We're going to go with Halo 5 is a fantastic game. I enjoy it a lot. I love playing it with my friends. The online stuff is a blast. Warzone's great. I know you don't like Arena as much. I love the Capture the Flag. I think the Capture the Flag is the best one out of all the Arena types. I think that one's very fleshed out, and I enjoy it.
Yeah, I'll agree with that.
Yeah, and then we will now go, well, I'll let you go first, top to bottom, or we'll go from the worst to the best. We'll go Halo games for yourself. Go.
Top to bottom?
Yeah, so, well, the worst to the best.
Oh, the worst to the best.
Yeah.
Halo Reach is the worst.
Okay.
I would say...
And this, by the way, this doesn't include any top-down stuff. So, like, Halo Wars doesn't count, and Spartan Assault doesn't count, and all that. So you don't have to worry about those ones.
Basic, like, the actual...
Yeah, stuff that actually involves with the Spartans, that's either Master Chief or we're first-person shooters. We'll just call it that way.
Yeah, okay, so that's why I'm going with Halo Reach, or Reach first. Then it's gonna be, I think, Halo 2, I didn't really like that much. Like, the start was okay, but it just felt kind of wonky.
Mm-hmm.
Then it's Halo DST... Just because it was kind of, I don't know, it was telling a story throughout the whole thing, but it would like cut, right? Like it wasn't as flowy.
Yeah.
So that kind of threw me off. And I did appreciate, though, that they gave us the perspective, but it's still not about the Master Chief, right? That's, I paid the game.
Because you wanted to be Chief. Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to see the Chief more and more and more, right? Okay, so then you go to Halo 3 after that. Well, no. I actually changed that. Halo 4 is definitely there.
Okay.
And then Halo 3, and then Halo 5.
Okay. All right. So, the way I would do it... okay, let me see here. So, for myself, Halo 2 is at the bottom.
Did I say Halo 1?
Yeah, you never put Halo in there.
Well, Halo 1 is definitely actually before 5. I think 5 is the best one they've done.
Yeah?
Halo 1 is just, like, under it. So, you would go from... 4, 3, 1, 5 Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, sorry.
All right. So for myself, I would say Halo 2 is the worst. I did not enjoy that one at all. I have no, especially when they announced the 10th anniversary thing, I had no interest in it. I would then go to, I'd go to Reach. Yeah, just because, I don't know, just like it was, and also the look, the visual look, I didn't like it because they dumbed down a lot of the colors. It wasn't as bright as Halo as I remember it was. So I wasn't a big fan of that. So I've done, so yeah, so that's two, Reach. I would go, oh my god, so I would put, I would do Halo 3, and then ODST. I loved ODST, I don't know what it was. I loved the look, the music, the acting, everything was just so superb, so I was a big fan of that. I would then put, I would go 4, 1, and 5. So for myself, 5 would be at the top as well.
Yeah. I think 5 really did, like I put it to you before, it saved the franchise.
Yeah.
Absolutely saved it.
Yeah.
Brought it back to what it should have been while patching the patches that happened between like 3 and 4.
Yeah. Basically. I like how we both still put number 1, which is like an over 10-year-old game, in second place.
Yeah. Well, because the story was excellent.
Yeah.
It was perfect. Like,
and I think for us, the flashbacks of us playing multiplayer, like, versus and stuff.
Yeah.
Pretty freaking funny, dude.
Yeah.
We have good times in that game. But anyways, that was our official hour-long talk about fucking Halo.
That's right.
So we're going to do a couple quick things here. Because let me see, I think we're approaching the hour mark. So let me see here. Let's see, what are we up to? We are up to, yeah, we got, ooh, we're really getting close to the hour mark. Okay, so rapid fire. Fucking Destiny doesn't work on Xbox One right now because of the new update.
Yes, not really that surprising. Okay, the only thing I want to really point out on this thing is the list of reasons, like, because they're saying basically the full screen, when you go from Destiny to another full screen thing, it's messing with Destiny. First of all, why? Hello? I mean, friends, party, makes sense. Twitch, if you're recording,
yeah, if you're streaming, but fine. that's still a Snappin' app. That's what
right?
You don't, but why open up an entirely different window?
This is the real kicker for me, Larche. Netflix.
Yeah, what the fuck? Why? Why the fuck?
Are you watching a movie?
Yeah.
While playing a game.
Yeah.
What?
Oh,
it makes no sense.
Oh, Jesus. By the way, it's not the hour mark, dude. We're at like... No, wait, no, because... Never mind.
Yeah, don't look at that.
Yeah, don't look at Skype time. Skype time's wrong.
Yeah, it's wrong.
OBS time is right. Yeah, no. We're good. We're good. I was about to say, we've been doing this for 2 hours!
Yeah, no.
Wait, okay, so that is...
Things up for first hour.
Yeah, fuck, man. Maybe we should have recorded that trouble. But anyways, Destiny, I don't give a fuck. I've lost interest after I played it with you. Never made it to the Vault of Glass. I don't think I feel like I have to. It's just repetitive work. Let's move on. What's the next one here? The next one is, real quick, the Red Cup controversy with Starbucks. What the fuck?
That's just the stupidest thing I've ever heard in my entire life.
So, I tried to read this, and my brain melted. I don't know how this is anti-Christian. It doesn't make any sense to me. And like you had said before, it for yourself, who you are a Christian, really puts a bad name to your religion, to your beliefs.
Well, it does. It's over a stupid cup. Who cares?
Yeah.
If it's red, if it's purple, if it's green, if it's, like, I don't even care what color they make it at all. Why is this guy making such a big deal and saying it's, what, they've removed Christmas somehow? First of all, remember, red is a Christmas color.
Yeah.
Where's the problem?
Yeah.
Where is the problem? It, like, the freaking company, do whatever it wants. If it wants to put naked chicks on there, fine. Then I have an issue. But other than that, and even then, I probably wouldn't have that much of an issue. So, I mean, the one thing is, the one picture is just freaking hilarious on there. The some of the people...
Oh, yeah.
Like, they're just putting these interesting things on there. And the one, I mean, it's kind of offensive in a way for me, but not really, because it's hilarious.
You found the humor in it.
Yeah, like, this one guy, he put a bunch of pictures of black meat on the red cup and said, oh, it's good for Christmas now.
yeah, that's fucking funny. So yeah, people, get your head out of your own asses. This is ridiculous. A cup's a cup. Let them do what they want. As long as there's no swastikas on it, or they're gay bashing, or making fun of a religion, who fucking cares?
I'm sorry.
Bam! Alright, this one is real quick. This is off GameSpot, this one. Despite the PS4 price cut, Xbox One tops October 2015 US sale consoles. Why? Because of Halo 5. That is pretty much it. That's the only reason why.
That's exactly, and that's what they said in the articles. Basically, because of all these, oh, they didn't say Halo 5, but because of all these top names or top game names, right? That's why they're getting so many sales. Well, of course, Halo 5, we're talking about one of the most followed FPSs that I've ever seen in my entire life. All right? This thing has a following that rivals Justin Bieber. So, I mean, of course Xbox One's going to win when you have a game with such a name. I mean, if PS4 decide to bring out a new Killzone that actually made sense, maybe they could rival. But even then, it doesn't have the same following.
It's here's what it is. This would be pretty much, in my mind, be the same thing is if they would have released the new Final Fantasy VII remake, which they said is happening, if they would have released it this holiday, yeah, you know what? PS4 would have outsold Xbox One, you know, in November, whenever they would have released it. That's just how it is.
But even then, with Fallout 4, you have Halo 5. There's another one.
Battlefront.
Some of the sports ones. Battlefront, yeah. Like, you cannot... PS4 is having a hard time competing again.
Mm-hmm.
And they're starting to lose all the players because the players are like, well, look what Xbox has. Sure, you got to pay for, what, Xbox One Live?
Yeah, but so same thing with the PlayStation now. PlayStation, their PlayStation Plus, which I'm pretty sure that's the only way you can play online games now, like, versus each other, is you have to get the PlayStation Network Plus account. So it's the same fucking thing now. I think it's a little bit cheaper, but not by much. And it's still, they have a lot of connectivity issues compared to what the Xbox One has. I'm not a fanboy. I'm just stating the facts. Simple as that. And there's another topic that I want to touch on, but we will talk about it next time, because I could talk about this one for a long time, which is Friday the 13th, The Game, which was a Kickstarter that got kick-started. Shut up! Doesn't matter. We're going to talk about it next time, because this is something that I'm very, very, very much looking forward to. But for now, guys, we are approaching that hour mark. It is late for us. It is midnight. We weren't originally even going to be recording until I had a couple beers and we wrecked house in Smite.
We kind of did.
Well, we wrecked house in Smite, man. We won both games.
Did we?
Yeah, the first joust, they forfeited.
Oh yeah, that was hilarious.
Yeah, I think we took out their Phoenix in like under 10 minutes. Or 10 minutes, it was like 10:45, and they quit. And then in Arena, we were losing the entire time. And then the last, like, 5 minutes, not even. Freaking Anubis gets a triple kill out of the blue when he didn't once get a kill. He gets a triple kill, and then we're at like 5 tickets left, and I punched Loki in the face, and then we won. Thank Christ! Like, that was unbelievable.
That was awesome.
Yeah. So that put us in a good mood. But yeah. Yes. And there's another thing we're going to talk about probably once it comes out, which is Dano had told us, Michael's brother, that there is a new god that's coming out next week. I can't remember his name, but it's the guy who trained Hercules. And apparently he's going to be a hunter. We're going to play him around, and then we'll talk about it next time. But for now, guys, thanks for joining us. This is our first attempt at a podcast. If you guys enjoy it, let us know. The only thing I can think of is if you have any topics you want us to talk about, hit us up on Twitter. You will see the tags in the video, so we don't have to shout it out. But yeah, guys, thanks for joining the Nameless Podcast, because I don't know what to call it yet.
I mean, what else would you call it?
I don't know. Well, I mean, there's like some Rooster Teeth has like the Rooster Teeth Podcast. Achievement Hunter has the Off Topic Podcast for a while. Rooster Teeth, they call themselves the Drunk Tank. Like, maybe we'll give ourselves a name. I don't know yet.
Or the SSN Podcast for now.
Yeah, for now. Or that might just stick. I don't know. I'm fucking lazy. But guys, thanks for joining us. We enjoy it as always. I'm Larche.
And I'm Mike.
So we'll talk to you guys
Have
later.
A good one.
Bye. Love you.